Okay. The more important thing I want to talk about today mm-hmm. is VARJO, the probably one of the most interesting pieces of hardware that I've seen this year, or probably since like I saw the Rift or the Vive for the first time.
Whoa.
Yeah. I mean, the Vive Pro was pretty cool. We had a whole episode about it. I talked about like, you know, higher resolution headset and what that looks like. Mm-hmm. Keep in mind, I haven't seen the Pimax. What's so
special about VARJO?
So VARJO, we've talked about them a little bit before. I think I call them VARJO or VARJO. It's VARJO. It's a Finnish company. And by the way, VARJO means shadow. They let me know that because it's important. So the trick about this company is that they're creating a headset that has what they call retina level resolution. So your eyes, you can see as good as your eyes can see. So to actually create this panel, they've combined two different panels. One panel that's pretty much the same as your Rift and Vive in terms of the field of view, how big it is, what it looks like. They might have done some things for this on the screen door effect. We actually didn't really speak about specs. Meeting I had with them was way more. Well, I wasn't even talking to them as like press or media for the podcast. We were talking more on like photogrammetry and mm-hmm. And having content for high resolution headsets. But the panel, yeah. So the panel looks like a Rift or a Vive. But the crazy thing is, in the middle of the panel is a way smaller version, like basically as big as your fovea, or slightly bigger than the fovea of your vision. The same resolution, but way smaller. So, like, the pixel density is incredibly dense.
Where did they get such a panel?
I don't know. What they're doing is basically using a mirror to display, mm-hmm. to project that smaller panel on top of the bigger panel. And then somehow they're doing they're feathering out the two displays. So you don't really see any transition. So they showed me a prototype from last year, from like November, which was the first one that they showed at Slush. And you can really tell the difference between the two panels, but you kind of got a good sense of like what the high resolution, what does a high resolution headset looks like. What they showed me this week was a prototype they made the week before, which didn't have the SteamVR tracking, integrated yet, although the first one did. And they had feathered the panels way better. The colors were, I think, more accurate. And like, just to give you a sense of like what I saw and how high res it was, because it's, for me, it was really hard to imagine what a, like having a Rift or a Vive, you can't really tell like what a higher resolution headset would look like. You know, it's hard to imagine somewhat, but this is how I can describe it. I was standing inside of a room looking at probably at the end of the room, looking forward to a wall where there was a TV, and the content that was playing on the TV, I could tell was like either 1080p or higher than 1080p. So, you know, when that feeling when you're in a room and you're looking at a 4K TV and you're like, whoa, like that's got some pixels in there, or like, you know, you could tell that mm-hmm. there's such dense amount of visual information. I'll give you, so that was one example. I was pretty impressed, and they're like, okay, you're here to see photogrammetry. Like, let's show you some photogrammetry. Mm-hmm. And one of their engineers had done a scan of an art gallery inside of this brick kind of room that had a bunch of like firewood on the side. And it was just like, everything was very raw and rocky or woody. And wow, dude, like it really blew open. Like, what I think photogrammetry will look like, or the detail that you can actually see in these models. So, I mean, standing again from across the room, I could look at a small wood chopped mm-hmm. piece of wood, and you can see the grooves on it really, really distinctly. And you could, like, honestly even makes the imperfections of photogrammetry somewhat more noticeable if you don't take care of it, because like you have such fine edges and corners that you just couldn't see before. So now we have access to that, and I don't know what the pricing on this is going to be. I don't know what the actual product even will be, for what controllers it'll come with, but I think it was just the most promising piece of technology that I saw.
It doesn't sound like, obviously mechanical parts are difficult to engineer, But we're not speaking about a 50K resolution screen, but rather, you know, two panels, one special panel, one normal panel, and then you need to move it around. It's obviously not cheap, but doesn't sound like it will, you know, be very expensive.
The one I tried, we've talked about them in the past, and I think their patents say that they're going to have the foveated version where they have an eye tracker in there, and it's kind of like a MEMS, tracking system.
Exactly.
Like it moves the mirror a little bit so that the high resolution panel follows your eye. The second version prototype that I tried did not have that, but despite that, like, it wasn't 100% necessary to have it even to get to get a better experience than what is possible now. And one of the demos I also tried was like standing inside of like a B-2 bomber. I think you can look straight forward and read the dials on the cockpit. Like, yeah, you can read it pretty well. And I'd say it's your vision in that foveated screen is pretty much just as good as you can in real life. So like the small text that you can't read in real life that's far away, you're not going to be able to read that in VR either. Like I think that's where the kind of cutting off point is.
Maybe my dream of just working in VR is coming closer.
Yeah, it's definitely getting closer. And like for someone that uses, let's say, big screen to read or doing a lot of like modeling work, you know, I think car manufacturers, plane manufacturers, like this is big for them. However, I will say this though. So things looked awesome from far away that you can read, but thinking about it on a smaller scale, since the actual the field of view of that high resolution display is kind of still small. So if you're standing next to a huge monitor, you're kind of going to see the variance between the really high res portions of the text and what's in your peripheral vision. So like they don't have that yet figured out, I guess, is that it's better to almost like stand further away and get all of it in high resolution than to stand pretty close or kind of close and get get an object to be, you know, somewhat blurry on the sides. So it's kind of hard to, I guess, describe also without visuals, but
yeah. But I think the audience got a good understanding how much it actually influenced your basically, I don't know, belief in VR. Maybe not, but more like you just said, it's similar to, you know, trying the good old Rift the first time.
Yeah.
However, in the pre-episode discussion that lasted for only 3 minutes. You mentioned that you were kind of disappointed by the augmented reality.
Oh, yeah, I did. So.